Okay, so I'm going to follow up on what we discussed yesterday morning about classical communication, and we'll discuss a protocol for private classical communication, which will build on the ideas for classical communication. Then I'll discuss some fundamentals, which if you don't know them, they're just sort of core fundamentals that are good to know for quantum information theory, and not just for this application, but in general. And then hopefully we'll have enough time for quantum communication, but we may have to compromise on that. Okay, so quick pop quiz. Can anybody tell me what sequential decoding is? So we're using in the context of classical communication. There's something the receiver was doing. He gets these code words. What does he do? Okay. Yeah, and so he just asks yes-no questions that are sort of quantum yes-no questions. So that's the main idea. Thank you. Okay. And the other main idea was random coding. Okay, and so the idea there was beforehand Alice and Bob are allowed to meet and agree upon some code, and we allow them to choose a code randomly. And this somehow worked well in the large limit of large block length. Okay, so just to remind you, the way random coding worked is for every message M in the message set, they'll choose some sequence XN randomly, okay, where N is the number of channel uses, and they'll choose a sequence according to this product distribution. And they do it independently for every symbol and for every message, okay? And this was helpful in the error analysis that we did at the very end. And for after they make this random choice, they assign some code word to the particular message M. And what I didn't show you, because there's a bit of technical detail, but you really got the conceptual part, is the most general case, we'd like to code for a quantum channel, and not necessarily this sort of classical input, pure state quantum output channel, right? So what we can do is, what they can do is use the ideas from the pure state case. But instead, what Alice will do at the input of the channel, so we'll have some quantum channel that I could say, I'll just write as some box N. Okay. And at the input, Alice will sort of induce some CQ channel, okay, where they have some mixed states rho x that are dependent on the symbol x for this classical input channel. Okay? And so this will induce some classical quantum channel. And Bill Coyce talked about completely positive trace preserving maps. It turns out that if a map is linear, trace preserving, and completely positive, then there's a representation theorem known as the Krauss representation theorem. So any map that satisfies those properties can be written in this form for some Krauss operators, AI, such that the sum of their squares is the identity. Okay. And so the way sequential decoding will work is we have mixed states instead at the output. So these should all really be, they should have an N in front, right? So this is the output of the many uses of the CQ channel that Alice induces at the input. And what comes out are tensor product states where N, the channel N, is applied to each of these quantum states. Okay? And what you need to do is figure out a test to test is it this code word or not? And you need this machinery called conditionally typical projectors. And I'm not going to get into detail on that because it gets a bit technical. But a conditionally typical projector is some projector such that if I act with it on this state, the probability that I get the outcome yes is very high. Okay, so it's 1 minus epsilon where I take n large enough and epsilon is arbitrarily small. Okay, so that's the main idea. And what you can show is that this quantity called the Halevo information by tradition, is an achievable rate. Yesterday we showed a particular entropy was an achievable rate, but more generally, this Halevo information is an achievable rate. I defined it over here. I don't know if everyone can see it. But it's this linear sum of entropies. So it's the entropy of the system X. So I can imagine evaluating this quantity with respect to this classical quantum state, right? So to evaluate this entropy, I would trace over Bob's system, right? And I would be left with just a classical state. It would be forgetting about this part, right? And it's just the entropy of that distribution. And then there's this term that's the entropy of Bob's system. I evaluate that by tracing over the X system. Okay, so it'll be an entropy of the average state. And then there's this joint entropy, which is subtracted off. And this is a correlation measure. It's a measure of the classical correlations that Alice can establish with Bob using the channel. Okay, and so this protocol justifies this Halevo information in an optimal way, in an operational way. Okay, now there's some extra freedom in this scenario, right? The only thing that's fixed is the channel, this channel N. Alice, they can optimize this quantity over the choice of the distribution on these letters and the choice of these states, okay? And so taking the maximization over all those parameters gives you a quantity known as the Halevo chi quantity, okay? And we'll just call that the Halevo information of the channel. So there's random coding establishes the code. Sequential decoding is the procedure. There exists a measurement that Bob can do to recover messages that Alice sends as long as the rate of communication is approximately this amount. Okay, so that's something we're going to use to get codes for private classical communication. Any questions about any of that? It's a bit of a mouthful. Okay. So, we'll talk about private classical communication, which is could be a reasonable model for quantum key distribution if you have this independent and identically distributed assumption for your channel. Then I'll talk about more fundamentals, and these are important things. You may have seen these before, maybe not, but they're useful. And then, depending on time, we'll talk about quantum communication. I'll at least describe the protocol for quantum communication. Okay. So, quantum wiretap channel, this is a generalization of a classical input quantum output channel. So, we'll allow for, there's this classical input X, and conditional on those, there's some state rho X that the channel prepares on the tensor product Hilbert space of Bob and Eve's system. Does anybody know who that is? Okay, so it's Bob Dylan, all right, good. So you get the channel to Bob Dylan and his harmonica by tracing over Eve, and you get the channel to Eve by tracing over Bob's system, okay? And this is what we'll think about for private classical communication. It's, again, simple enough to capture what's going on, and then you can extend this to more general quantum channels. Okay, so the objective now is to send as much data to Bob as Alice can, while making this data private from Eve. And I'll define what I mean by private very soon. Okay, so at first I want to motivate a correlation measure which will characterize the rate at which they can communicate privately. Okay, and the correlation measure, you can imagine that we're again going to use random coding. So there'll be some distribution that corresponds to the selection of code words, this distribution P of X. And we'll have a classical quantum state to characterize these correlations that they can establish. And maybe your first guess, you know, based on what we said for classical communication, you can make a guess at a quantity which would characterize this rate. And this guess is just the difference of the classical correlations that Alice can establish with Bob and those that Eve can gain about X. Okay, and so that sort of intuitively captures the private classical communication rate. We're going to justify this as a measure. And of course, there'll be a maximization over the choice of this input parameter, P of X. Yeah. B here is, okay, so what I've done, this is the channel that I showed in the previous slide, this rho x, BE. And so I'm embedding that channel into this classical quantum state, right? And what I have here is a mutual information evaluated on this classical quantum state. The way I obtain this, I just trace over Eve's system and I evaluate this function right here. Right, the way that I say this information function, similarly I trace over Bob. And so that's these Halevo information quantities. We're going to show, this is different from, say, an accessible information where Bob could perform some measurement, there would be a classical output, and then we would evaluate an information quantity. This is stronger. This would be an upper bound on the accessible information. Okay. So we're going to show that this rate is achievable, and I'll try to justify it to you. Question?
How does this relate to the one-time hat?
So this is the rate at which you could establish a secret key that you could then use for a one-time pad, right? But it's also a bit stronger than that. It's the rate of private classical communication. So whatever message Alice is sending, Eve couldn't get anything about that. Asymptotically negligible as the number of channel uses get large. Okay. So the task will be similar to the task that we talked about before. This figure doesn't exactly correspond to the channels, but just imagine that this is a classical, these are all classical inputs and these are quantum outputs. Okay. So Alice has some message M, she'll do some encoding into classical code words like these, but I'm going to talk about that more particularly on the next slide. So she'll do some encoding and send in some code word into the channel. Something will come out for Bob, something will come out for Eve. Bob will have to do some collective measurement on all the channel outputs to recover the message variable M. And the thing that's different now is we need to think about how to keep the message private from Eve. So we need a bit more machinery to do that. Okay, so now there's going to be three measures of performance, the first of which is the rate. That's what we're concerned with. And again, this is just going to be the binary logarithm of the message set size. So that's the number of bits in a message that Alice is transmitting in a given code word divided by the number of channel uses. So the rate is bits per channel use. The probability of error, again, we're concerned with this. We want the transmission to be reliable for Bob so that he can recover the message M. So if M prime is his decoding, you know, the classical message that, or his estimate of M, we want this to be small. And now there's a new parameter I'm going to introduce, okay, for the private scenario. And this will be Eve's Halevo information about the message M. We want this to be small, okay? And so this e to the n, it represents all of Eve's systems that are at the output of the channel. And this is a good measure of security, and I'll try to justify that on the upcoming slides. Okay, so what we want in the asymptotic limit is for the probability of error to go to zero, Eve's Halevo information about just the message m to go to zero as well, as n gets large at some fixed rate. And so then again, the rate r becomes the only performance measure in this information theoretic sense. Okay? And then a rate r is achievable such that, you know, if there exists a sequence of codes that satisfy these criteria. Okay? So now, the random coding will be a bit different. We're going to have two indices, one of which will be for the message M that Alice wants to transmit, and another index for randomization, Okay, so this is something extra that Alice is doing to confuse Eve. And we want the message M to be undecipherable for Eve, so it's some extra noise that Alice will add to mask M in some way. Okay, and so the way that you'll pick a random code is very similar, except you'll do it for every index M and index K. Okay? So it'll be a doubly indexed code. Right. So you'll pick each code word XN according to this distribution. And this will lead to quantum code words at the output of the channel. Okay, so each of these should really have a superscript BE, because they're going to both Bob and Eve, these density operators. But we had the model of the channel, right? If we input X, out comes rho XBE. And so if Alice feeds in a classical sequence XN, out will come this tensor product of density operators. Okay, so that comes from the channel model. Okay? Now, I'll just argue from before, when we talked about sequential decoding, that Bob can get both the message and this noise variable, which doesn't have any information, if the size, the product of these set sizes, is exponential in the Halevo information of the channel going to Bob. Okay? So this just comes from before. There exists some measurements that Bob could use to get both M and K if these message set sizes are approximately this size. Okay? Now what we need to argue is, what I will argue is that this size of the randomization variable, the size of the set for this randomization variable, has to be about exponential in the Halevo information to Eve. Okay? And so then you can see by a simple calculation, if I just divide, you know, this bottom formula, or if I divide the top formula by the bottom formula, the message set size will be approximately this size, right? And so that's the main idea behind private classical communication, okay? But there's more. Okay. So let's think about this condition for Eve's Halevo information. Okay, we didn't really say a particular quantum state on which we would evaluate this Halevo information like we were doing before. Okay, so what I'll do is establish a classical quantum state corresponding to the classical messages, M, and this randomization variable, K, and the state that comes out of the channel whenever Alice sends in both M and K. Okay, so this sort of represents that joint state. If Alice were to keep a copy of M and K on her side, okay? So the message M could be picked any way that Alice wants, right? We have to guarantee that. But for simplicity, I'm going to just assume that Alice is picking it uniformly at random. But you could really put any distribution there, and all of this analysis that I'm going to show you is not going to change. Okay? The randomization variable has to be picked uniformly at random. That's very important for this analysis to work out properly. Okay? So this is the extra noise that Alice is using, and it has to sort of fill out a space by picking it uniformly at random. Okay? So the quantity that we're interested in is the Halevo information between Eve systems and the message M. Okay, so in order to evaluate this, I'll trace over Bob's systems, and I'll get some states just living on Eve's systems. And then also, we're just interested in the Halevo information that Eve has about the message M. So that means we trace out K as well to evaluate this information quantity. Okay, and then you see how this noise variable is averaging over these states on Eve's side. Okay, and if we can guarantee that these states right here, there's a dependence on M, right, in each of these states. But if we can guarantee that actually when I average over the randomization variable, there's no dependence on M, if this is just a constant state for every M, then it means that Eve can't get anything about M, and this Halevo information will be going to zero. So this is the crux of the argument. Any questions about that? Oh. Well, in that case, right, so you want to choose K to be any distribution besides uniform. Is that right?
Yes. Any distribution besides uniform and any distribution besides the one that M is using.
Oh, well, those distributions will be independent. I mean, if K is chosen uniformly at random. But the more important thing is that what I'm going to do is, again, invoke. See, this is looking like a sample mean, right? This is looking like a sample mean of these operators, right? And so I'm again going to invoke the law of large numbers to make this argument. In order for that to work out properly, this needs to be chosen uniformly at random. But again, it's sort of this idea of adding uniformly random noise in some way to Eve's state. Okay, and that's sort of the worst type of noise that you could add to a state to destroy correlations. Okay. So, what I'm going to call on is, I'm just going to invoke this sort of elephant gun that Andreas Winter came up with. I don't want to get into the details of it, but it's all in that textbook. It's in an appendix. It's worked out. So you can look at everything carefully. But if you're familiar with the Chernoff bounds, which is often used to get exponential types of convergence bounds, then this is very similar. It's just sort of the operator version of that. Okay, so what I want to argue is that this quantity right here is kind of like a sample mean, and I want to be arguing that it's converging to its true mean. Okay, and so we're going to be using this probabilistic method again. So we're choosing, or Alice and Bob are choosing the code words randomly, according to some distribution, right? So I can think of some ensemble for these states that are being chosen randomly. Okay, and so this ensemble has a product distribution and some conditional states that are prepared on Eve's side based on these sequences xn. And so the average of this ensemble is just some tensor power state. Okay, so if you were to work things out, the rho xn's are tensor product states like this, right? Except the m is suppressed. So if I were to average these over a product distribution, this first one would average to some rho, this would average to some rho as well, and then you know they would all average to a rho that I'm defining that way, and the full average will be rho tensor m. Okay, so that's the true mean of this ensemble, okay? So the question then becomes, how many of these states, rho xn, do we need to pick randomly in order to guarantee with high probability that this sample mean operator is close to the true mean? And so it becomes, again, like a probabilistic convergence argument. Okay? And so the answer to that question is that if you choose at least an amount, if you choose this message set size, k, to be exponential in the Halevo information to Eve, then this will be converging very fast in probability to these this true mean operator. And in fact, it's doubly exponential in the number of channel uses. Okay, and why is that so? There's sort of a trade-off between how close this true mean operator is to this operator, maybe in trace distance. And the convergence from the Chernoff bound-like argument, if you're familiar with Chernoff bounds from probability theory, the convergence is always exponential, okay, in the size of the set that you're sampling over. Okay, and so these two parameters are sort of fighting against one another. And if it turns, you know, it turns out that if you choose this message set size to be just slightly larger than the Halevo information, you can show that the probability with which this is happening So I'm just going to write down this sort of rough condition. it'll be approximately, larger than 1 minus an exponential going like this. Okay, so this delta, again, is it's actually a typicality parameter. It's just a very small number, okay? You can make that as small as you want. And so you just sort of, even though that delta is really tiny, when n is large, this is going to happen really fast, right? This is doubly exponentially fast. And so intuitively, you can now see that not only is the Halevo information a measure of creating correlations, but also it's a measure of the destruction of correlations, because it's telling me about how much noise I need to be adding to these states in the form of this randomization variable k, such that the correlations are destroyed, that all of these are converging just to some constant states. Okay, so that's how we can get privacy. So if you want to look this up, this is the, I'm appealing to the Alsvedi-Winter operator Chernoff bound, which is used not only in this context, but also in quantum state tomography. There are many people who are relating that task to compressed sensing type of things. And they're appealing to this operator Chernoff bound to make convergence arguments. Okay, so it's found some pretty widespread applications. Okay, so now we just need to argue that all the things we want to happen will happen if we choose the code randomly. Okay, so I'm just going to call this E0. So we have this random selection of the code words, right? And so this is what we're going to be taking probabilities over. And I'll let E0 be the event that Bob can decode well. And so we argued yesterday that this will happen, as long as n is large enough that there exists a decoder for Bob such that he can get the message m from Alice with asymptotically negligible probability of error. Okay. Now we have some additional events that we want to happen as well. We have these events that I'll call em, and it'll be the event that the message m is private from Eve in the sense that I was talking about on the previous slides. Okay, and so we want all of these things to happen, right, when we're choosing the code randomly. And so we want the intersection of these events to happen. And if there's just a little bit of probability under a random choice of code that these things will happen, then it means there exists a code such that all of these things are satisfied. Okay. So, anyone want to take a guess at what I'm going to do next? Kind of talked about it yesterday. It was early in the morning. So we have an intersection of events. I'm going to consider the complement of these. And then the union bound, exactly. So we're going to use the union bound, and I'm going to just show that the complement of all these things are very small. All right. So that's what it is. So the probability, again, is with respect to the random choice of code. And we're going to consider the complement of each of these events. Remember, there's an exponentially large number of these events because the message set is exponential in the number of channel uses, right? So that's where we're going to need that doubly exponentially fast convergence. So if I apply De Morgan's law and then the union bound, I'll have the probability of the complement of this event E0 that Bob can't decode well, or that Bob can decode well. And then we'll have the sum of all of these events, which are the probability that the messages are not private from Eve. And I argued before that this would hold with this probability under a random selection of code words. And so if the complement of this event, I just flip the sign and subtract one and flip the sign there. And so that event, the complement of those events are going doubly exponentially fast to zero. Okay, so a doubly exponential will beat an exponentially increasing term, and we can make all of these things go to zero. So in fact, we can conclude that the large fraction of code selected in this way will do well, but n has to be very large, right? So that's kind of remarkable, I think, you know, that this, you know, seemingly dumb way of picking a code randomly works out well, but n has to be large. Okay. So, yeah, we conclude a code exists. So just a quick summary of how that works. We have this doubly indexed code book. There's a message variable. There's a randomization variable. If Alice wants to send message M, she selects K uniformly at random, transmits this classical code word over the quantum channel corresponding to the message. And Bob will decode both M and K by sequential decoding. The one he's really interested in is M. He doesn't have to get K, but it turns out that that's useful when we'll construct quantum codes in the upcoming slides. Okay, and then we can guarantee that Eve's Halevo information about the message is asymptotically negligible. And by optimizing over the choice of a distribution, this quantity right here is the rate at which Alice can send messages to Bob privately, such that Eve can't get anything. Okay. So now, we'll go on to more fundamentals. These are these tools that will be helpful, you know, not just for this QIT stuff, but all over the place. So, a lot of people call this the church of the larger Hilbert space. I think John Smolin invented this terminology. There's a Facebook group, and he's the leader of this Facebook group. Anyway, there's a lot of people on it. It's kind of weird. But so it's not a religion. Well, I think maybe some people it is. But anyway, so this is a very useful abstraction in quantum information theory. Because if you have noise, you can always just purify it to a larger reference system. And it's helpful to just purify everything and then trace out. And then if you purify everything, you sort of see the whole picture. You know, and so I always do that. That's like the first thing I do. Okay. So what is this idea of purification? If I have a density operator rho, I can diagonalize it. We talked about this yesterday. These lambda z eigenvalues will be, they correspond to a probability distribution, and these states z are orthonormal. So you can think of them as effectively classical. But the purification idea is just come up with some state on a larger reference system. Okay, so it's the tensor product of your original system in a larger reference system, such that if you trace over the reference system, you get the original state back. Okay, so that's the idea. And the simplest choice to do, sort of the canonical choice, is take your orthonormal basis, sort of coherently copy these states such that the reference has this z variable as well. This is a pure state, right? These states here, so this whole thing is a pure state. But if I trace over this system right here, I'll get these delta functions, and then the remaining state will be this density operator. So that's a useful calculation you should do, but it's easy. So more interestingly, you may not have seen this, we can purify a quantum measurement. So if there's some POVM lambda with elements lambda x, where the x corresponds to the classical outcome of the measurement, I can purify this as well. So the idea here is to take these operators, lambda x from the POVM, put a square root on them, and this is an operator that I'm tensoring with a vector, okay, so this pure state x, right? So I'm just tensoring a matrix with a vector, and that's going to be rectangular. It's going to be a rectangular matrix. Right, if you work it out, you'll see that. And a rectangular matrix, which kind of acts like a unitary, is called an isometry because it's length preserving. Okay, and so this is sort of the standard way in QIT to purify a POVM or make it an isometry. So how does this, you may be looking at this object and it looks all weird, but you can define the way it acts sort of in a natural way. So this U means that it's an isometry, or kind of it indicates that it's kind of like a unitary, and it's acting on a sole system on Alice's, you know, that Alice has. So it'll act on some state psi that Alice is feeding in, and it outputs to a larger tensor product Hilbert space, A and X. Okay, so its action on an input state is defined in this way. And then this right here is a legitimate quantum state, so everything's fine, right? And so often you'll hear people say, and I'll probably say it, we coherently measure a quantum state. And so this is what we mean by that. Okay. So I'll show you in the next slide why this is like a unitary. So this is a useful exercise. I'm going to show you it. Okay. So if I take U dagger U, I'm going to want that to be the identity. That's the isometry. That's the isometry property. Okay. So it's the identity on Alice's input system. Okay. So if I want to take U dagger, these are Hermitian anyway, so the dagger doesn't do anything. And then the dagger for a ket takes it to a bra, right? So this acts, the dagger acts linearly and all that. So this whole U operator that I defined previously, its conjugate transpose will be defined in this way, okay? And so these two will come together in the natural way, right? This operator here will meet with this one in this way, and this bra will meet this ket. Okay, in the usual way that you would expect. Okay, so there's nothing funny going on. And these are defined to be orthonormal, right? This basis x. And so when they meet, it makes a delta function. The x prime becomes the x, and then we're left with the sum over lambda x. And so from the POVM condition, you see that this is a legitimate isometry. And any isometry you can do by taking an ancilla in a pure state and doing a unitary. So this is a legitimate physical operation, but I'm just going to do the isometries because it's easier to deal with that. Okay. So now, if we can do it with POVMs, why not channels? Right? Nothing prevents us from doing that. So Bill Coyce was talking about how, you know, a channel is a unitary on if I tensor the system with an ancilla and perform the unitary that I, and then if I trace over the environment, I get the channel. That's another way of getting a channel. It's a very similar thing, except I'm only specifying part of the unitary in this isometry because it's a rectangular part, so it's just a slice of a unitary matrix. Okay, so the canonical way to do it is I take the Krauss operators, I tensor them with an orthonormal basis for the environment, very similar to what we did for the POVM. Right, and this is an operator taking Alice's input to Bob's output, and then this is a state that will be prepared on Eve's system. Okay, so the way that it will act is very similar to the way that the extension of the POVM will act. Right, so if Alice feeds in a ket x or a ket psi, and this isometry acts, the A system will be fed in here, and this Krauss operator will act on it. And this state here that's correlated with the Krauss operator will be prepared on Eve's system. Okay, and that's how it acts. Very similar way to what we did on the previous slide. If you take U dagger U and then use the fact that the sum of the squares of the Krauss operators is the identity, you can verify that this is an isometry. Okay. Any questions about this? This is not the usual thing that people show, right? I thought it was odd when I first saw it. I was like, what is going on? Okay, and then if you trace over the system E, since these states are orthonormal, they'll cancel with delta functions in the same way, and we'll get the action of the original channel. So this is an isometric extension of a quantum channel. And it's not unique, right? This could be any orthonormal basis on Eve. It doesn't matter which one you pick. Yeah. Okay, so another thing I want to talk about is the quantum fidelity. This is a different measure we can use. It's not a distance measure per se, like the trace distance, but if you play around with it a bit, you can turn it into a distance measure, and people do that sometimes. I'm not going to show that. So you can think of it like as a measure of closeness between two pure states. So if I have a state psi and a state phi, I want to compute the fidelity. I like to define it as the squared overlap, because it has an operational interpretation if you do so. If you don't have the square, then there's no operational interpretation. So some people, they like to put the I don't like putting the square because then you're always putting square roots and everything. But I like having the square because it's operational interpretation. So what is that? It's the probability that one state would pass a test for being the other. Okay? So if I want to test whether the state psi is phi, this is the measurement I would do. I would just ask, is it phi or not? You know, I just want to get one, I just want to know one thing, right? And so if you do this test and you calculate the success probability, it's the fidelity between these two states. So it has this nice little cute operational interpretation. And I wrote this whole thing. So Ullman called his original paper, this is why I really like the square. And you know, he was sort of, I think he invented the fidelity, right? I mean, everybody calls it the Ullman fidelity. And he called his paper the transition probability in the state space of a star algebra. And he put probability there, so you need the square, right? Okay. So, all right, so how do we define the fidelity for mixed states? You can take that idea from the previous slide and use purifications of mixed states, okay? So if rho and sigma are the density operators that I'm thinking about computing their fidelity, what I can do is take, I can consider two particular purifications. So there'll be a purification, I'll call it phi rho. Oops, this thing is running out. Oh, there it is. Phi rho is a purification of the state rho on some larger reference system. Phi sigma is a purification of the state sigma. I compute the squared overlap, like I was doing in the previous slide, except now there's another degree of freedom, right? We can maximize over all possible purifications of the states. And you may get a different value if you choose fixed purification. So you just maximize over all choices. Now, one thing I didn't show you, which is important, but all purifications are related by unitary. So just show that real quick. If we have a state like this, we said it purifies to this right here, where this is A and this is R. Right, so this is some arbitrary orthonormal basis. And I could choose any orthonormal basis, and I could, you know, they're all related by unitaries. So there's an extra degree of freedom, right? If I put a unitary here and I trace over R, I'll get the same state back, right? And so it's a legitimate purification with any unitary there. So that's how this optimization comes about. So, since all purifications are related by unitaries, I forgot this little thing. I can, you know, pick a unitary acting on the reference of phi rho, a unitary acting on the reference of phi sigma. If I multiply unitaries together, it's still a unitary, and so the optimization is just over all unitaries. If I fix two purifications of rho and sigma, and then optimize over all possible unitaries acting on the purification system, this is an equivalent definition of the fidelity. You can show that this is true. This actually, I'm not going to use this for the rest of the slides, but this is a nice little formula for the fidelity that you can show. There's a whole proof you can use to show this using the polar decomposition, so it might be useful to write it down. Okay, but this idea of Ullman's, where you're optimizing over unitaries to calculate fidelity, is extraordinarily useful in quantum information theory. Okay. And we're going to use that to build decoders for quantum codes. Okay. So one other thing that I want to talk about to prepare us is this idea of a coherent gentle measurement, right? So now everything's pure, and we need a new notion of gentle measurement because that was for mixed states, right? So if I have a set of states, rho sub k, such that a POVM with elements corresponding to these states, if it can identify these states well, in the sense that the probability of getting outcome k when the state prepared was rho k, if that probability is very high, then you would we said the gentle measurement lemma would hold for the mixed state case, right? But now I'm going to argue for purifications that it holds as well. Okay. So, if you take a purification of each state rho k of this form, right? So there's, I'm assuming the rho k's are on Alice's system and we purify to a reference system. Then if I take a coherent version of a POVM that I showed you before, right? So you can think that this is acting on Alice's system and then coherently placing this variable k in a register big K. So the statement of the coherent gentle measurement lemma is that this isometric extension of the POVM, when acting on this purification system, the resulting state will be approximately this pure state, okay? So how would you prove this? You would, you could take this side and make it, you know, take the dagger so that everything is a bra, and take this side as well, and then have them meet together, and then analyze how things are canceling with, you know, orthonormality and delta functions. And then you can show that, so that's a fidelity, right, because it's an overlap of pure states. And you can show that when you go through everything, you'll get this condition, that the fidelity has to be larger than 1 minus epsilon. You need an extra little trick to do that, but it's a worthwhile exercise. So why is this useful? If we have a superposition of states as well, this will act linearly, and so we'll end up with a superposition, a corresponding superposition, where we've identified the state psi k coherently, okay? And that will be useful for quantum error correction. This is a different way of thinking about quantum error correction. Like Dan Gosman had this whole way with the stabilizer formalism, but this is definitely a different way of thinking about things. Prove that. Okay, so what is the decoupling idea? This will be the idea for building a decoder, okay, for Bob. So let me draw a circuit diagram. Circuit diagrams are always helpful. Okay, so suppose that there's some state psi RA that Alice is feeding into a unitary. So you can think of this as like your encoder for a quantum code, right? And then she feeds it into the isometric extension of the channel. We want to purify everything because then we have everything in our hands, right? So out comes something for Bob and something for Eve. Okay, so the idea with the decoupling idea is that trace over Bob and think about the reduced state, okay? So I'll call that, I call the incoming state psi and I call this outgoing state phi, okay? This lives on R, B, and E. This lives on R and A. So if I trace over Bob, I'll get some state phi living on R and E. And if it turns out that this is very close to a state that's a product state between the reference and the environment, then we're going to use Ullmann's theorem to make an argument. These are the old version of the slides. Okay, so what I want to say, if I trace out B and E, nothing happened here, right? Just the identity happened. So I can call this the state psi r, okay? I can call it phi r or psi r, but it's the same thing because the identity, nothing's happening on the reference, right? So if that turns out to be close, maybe by the action of this unitary, if this is a good encoder, if this is a tensor product state between the reference and the environment, then if these are close, the fidelity is close, right? And we have that definition of fidelity from Ullmann. So I can think about purifications. So one fixed purification of this state, phi RE, is this state, phi R, B, and E, right? Now, a purification of this state is psi, since this isn't a product state, I can have psi R, and I'll call this a system B1, okay? So I'm purifying this right here, purifying this, purifying this. And since this is a product state, I can take the purifications independently. And so I'll just call this some purification omega. And the thing is, since overall, since we're in this larger Hilbert space where everything was pure and we kept track of things, who has the purification? So I traced out who to get this state, right? I traced out Bob, right? So Bob has the purification of these. Or I can say that Bob has the purification, that's fine. So now, since these are close in fidelity, I know from Ullmann's theorem there's some unitary acting on the purifying system that Bob has, right? There's some unitary, or more generally, an isometry going from B to B1 and B2, right? Such that this is approximately equal to this. So this unitary right here can function as Bob's decoder, right? This is the state coming out of the channel on R, B, and E. If I act with this unitary that's guaranteed to exist by Ullmann's theorem, it will take Bob's state to something on B1 and B2, such that in this system B1, Bob has recovered the quantum correlations with the reference that you want to preserve in any quantum error correction task. And the environment Bob has something else that's correlated with the environment, but that's sort of junk that he can trace over at the end of the protocol. So that's the decoupling idea. And we're going to use that in a quantum error correction code. Okay. So now we're on to this part. Does anybody have questions about that? Because this is really important. And I don't want to, you know, move along too fast if there's questions about that. This is a very important way to think about quantum error correction. So it's just this appeal to Ullmann's theorem, which is essentially about the structure of quantum mechanics, right? Okay, so now I'm going to show you how to take the private code for communication and turn it into a quantum code. And I have 5 minutes, so I'm going to go relatively quickly. Okay, so the task here is Alice wants to communicate what's in some quantum system A1. She does some encoder to the inputs of many uses of a quantum channel. Out comes something for Bob, and there has to exist some decoder such that he'll recover what's in A1. Okay. And so the conditions for a good code, we'll just think about the task of entanglement generation. So this is where Alice is preparing some maximally entangled state. Before we thought about M as the message size, the message set in this quantity, mod M is the message set size. So now this will be like the number of qubits that Alice can send to Bob, or the amount of entanglement that she can establish with Bob. Okay. And for a quantum code to be good, it has to hold that if Alice inputs one share of this maximally entangled state into an encoder, sends that through many uses of the channel, and then Bob decodes, it should be close to the maximum entangled state that Alice sent, okay? And, you know, epsilon is some arbitrarily small positive number, and N is getting large again, okay? This rate is qubits per channel use. So, I'm gonna skip over some of this, sorry. Okay, so what I'd like to think about is a CQ channel, a classical input quantum output channel that you can induce from a quantum channel. Okay, so if Alice has some density operator P of x, psi of x that diagonalizes like this, I want to think about the wiretap channel. So if Alice were to send these states, psi x a, through the isometric extension of the channel we're interested in coding for, then this is an isometry, so what comes out will be a pure state, and I'll just call it psi x b e. Okay? And so that's the wiretap channel I want to think about. And we're going to take the wiretap code and convert it into a code for quantum communication. Okay? And so at the beginning, we talked about this doubly indexed wiretap code with these classical code words, XN, M, and K. We know that Bob can decode M and K well, and Eve can't get M, right? So we had this K that averaged over the states of Eve to randomize her states such that she wouldn't be able to get M. So the identity I didn't show you is that if we calculate the private information of a state of this form, you can prove that it's equivalent to a quantity called the coherent information of the channel, okay? And since we showed that the rate of a wiretap code is equivalent to this, and this equivalence holds, we'll be able to show that the coherent information is an achievable rate for quantum communication. That's a useful thing to work out. The coherent information is defined. If I have this state, I'll call it rho. If I send it through the isometric extension of the channel, there'll be, you know, these states will live on B and E. And if you compute the entropy of Bob and subtract off the entropy of Eve, this is a quantity called the coherent information. Okay, and so that's what we're showing is an achievable rate. Okay, so what I want to do is take the wiretap code, think about this CQ channel, construct a coherent version of the wiretap code, and this is kind of like a CSS code, where I'm summing these code words over this randomization variable, okay? But this is a superposition, this is a pure state, and this is a classical code word M, okay? So the encoding will be on Alice's side. There's some unitary that will take this message M to these encoded states, right? And so you can write this state in this form, okay, using the definition on the previous slide. So now I'm going to go quickly, just because I want to show you the idea. Sorry about the time issue. So Bob has some POVM that he can use to recover M and K, right? So now he's going to make a coherent version of that, where he coherently recovers M and K. He'll perform that on what he gets from the channel, right? So what he gets from the channel are the BN systems. And since the wiretap code is good, the state after he performs this coherent POVM will be approximately close to this, where here he's identified in superposition M and K. Okay? And then rewriting things, I'm just going to permute the systems, bring B1 over here, and the BNs and ENs over here, and the K here. Okay, you can write the overall state in this form. And for each of these states, I'll think about a particular state over here for a fixed m, okay? That's this state right here. And then we'll just trace over Bob, right? We'll trace over Bn and B2. And we get these states right here that are like the sample averages we had before in the private wiretap code, right? And we know from the wiretap code that each of these is close to a constant state. So then we're going to appeal to Ullman's theorem. And for each of these states, there's a unitary depending on each message m, because each of these depends on m, taking this to a constant state. Okay? And so the second part of Bob's decoder will be, he'll perform this controlled decoupler. Okay? So this part will act on the M system that he's identified in the first step. And this part is there just to decouple Eve, to send these to a constant pure state. Okay, and when he does that, the overall state will be the desired one, where they've established maximal entanglement. And there's some state on Eve that's decoupled. So I'll stop there. There are many different ways to prove that the coherent information is achievable. This is one way. There are many different ways, and it's worth understanding them and looking at them. One approach that I like a lot is that of Joe Renna's. So overall in this talk, we had all these techniques for private, classical, and quantum communication. I didn't show you many things. I showed you the achievability parts of coding theorems because I thought those were sort of the fun parts where all this random coding happens and it's interesting. There are converses, and these are really important. You want to show that the codes you're constructing are optimal in some sense. So you need to have converse proofs. You need to try to prove them. And this has been the very difficult part in quantum information theory. There are all these additivity issues of the measures that I showed you. You want them to be, it'd be ideal if they were additive as a function of channels, but they're not generally. For many channels, they are additive, and in those cases, it means we can have capacity theorems. So there are many open questions. Look for practical encoding schemes. We did some work on polar codes, and this is progress towards this, but there are still open questions there. Find better formulas for the capacities. This is probably hard. Think about quantum information theory for networks. There's a whole field of relativistic quantum information theory. There's going to be a conference at Perimeter Institute. And quantum information theory for bosonic channels is a very rich area. Okay, thank you very much.